Hi, my name is Claire Ryan. I'm the coordinator of the Midwest Invasive Plant Network and of the Woody Invasives of the Great Lakes, or Wiggle Collaborative. This video is about the invasive tree, black locust, Robinia pseudoacacia. I'll tell you briefly about how this species range has grown in North America, why it is invasive, and then we'll look at how to identify it in the field. This is possibly the most controversial species covered by the Wiggle Collaborative because it's a North American native. Now, typically when ecologists think about what's native and what isn't, they're thinking a much smaller scale than national or continental. The historic native range of black locust is really quite small and constrained to the Appalachian and Ozark mountain ranges and then small pockets in southern Illinois and Indiana. The historic range is hard to determine because it's likely indigenous people moved and cultivated this tree. However, we do know today that this species can be found in all of the lower 48 states and much of Canada as well. It's not native to the Great Lakes Basin, and it's invasive to several important habitats of the region. Human planting has been the main vector of spread. The seeds of this species are large, so they tend to fall close to the parent tree. It's most problematic in dry, open habitats like pine barrens, dunes, sand prairies, and black oak savannas, all of which we have here in the Great Lakes region. These are nutrient-poor systems where a nitrogen-fixing tree like black locust has an advantage. It's common along disturbed urban and riparian corridors as well, along woodland edges, rights of way, and old fields. The only habitats that are really safe are wetlands and closed canopy forests. Black locust can form dense single-species stands by self-seeding and by vegetative growth from the roots, sometimes called suckering. Let's take a look at some important identification features. The leaves are alternately arranged and compound, with each leaf being composed of 7 to 9 leaflets. The leaflets are 1 to 2 inches long and oval, with small notches at the tips. If you were comparing with honey locust, which is a similar looking species and closely related, honey locust leaflets are more linear, thinner, and without notches. And the leaves of honey locust are sometimes double compound. The foliage color of black locust is kind of a dull blue-green, where honey locust foliage is more of a medium green and can be glossy. Mature trees of black locust are 40 to 60 feet tall, with an oval-shaped crown up to 30 feet across. The mature bark, which you can see here, is medium to dark gray with deep vertical ridges. Young bark is pretty much the same color, but without those notable ridges. Thorns can be another important identification feature, but they're not always present, and they're most easily observed on suckers or clones. But when they're there, the thorns are paired together and are pretty small, usually 1/4 inch to 1.5 inches long. Honey locust thorns, on the other hand, if those are present, are more than 1.5 inches long and clustered. They are some serious armor on that tree. Black locust flowers in the mid to late spring in drooping clusters about 4 to 8 inches long. Each flower is about 1 inch long, and the flower color is usually white. The seeds are borne in long, pea-like pods, 2 to 4 inches long, that dry to brown and crack open, releasing 4 to 10 seeds. Another thing to consider if you have black locust on an agricultural property or where you have a lot of pets outdoors is that the seeds of this species can be acutely toxic if ingested. If you have black locust on your property, we recommend that you consider removing it and replacing it with a non-invasive tree. Unfortunately, black locust is a difficult tree to manage due to its suckering habit and the formation of a long-lived seed bank. Thornless honey locust is a potential replacement in urban settings, although it's overplanted in a lot of places. Or Kentucky coffee tree is another great native option with compound leaves, but it can also be messy. Male cultivars of Kentucky coffee tree are often preferred in urban settings because they don't drop messy pods. You can learn more about control techniques and alternatives on woodyinvasives.org. Please subscribe to our channel for more useful videos like this one. Thanks so much!